Hi everyone! You caught me supplementing with creatine. Tune in to this episode of X-Fizz Ninja to find out if it works.
Okay, as you can see here, I've illustrated the entire immediate energy system on the board behind me. I'd like for you to check this out in your ninja slides. I'd also like to highlight that in your ninja slides, there is an overview or a summary slide for the immediate system. You'll see a summary slide for the glycolytic system and also mitochondrial respiration. In those summary slides, there's a variety of categories, such as the specific metabolic processes that are involved, the fuel sources that are involved, the ATP synthesis rate, the duration that this energy system can last, where it's happening within the cell, whether oxygen is required, and what the optimal fiber type is. So I encourage you to memorize those summary slides. In fact, consolidate the summary slides between the immediate system and the glycolytic system and the mitochondrial respiration. You could make a table out of those, and that might offer really easy comparisons from system to system to system. One thing to note before we get going into this is that you should be able to draw this entire energy system. In your ninja slide, you'll see a pencil indicated in the top right-hand corner of this particular energy system. Anytime you see a pencil, it means you should be able to draw it. And when I say draw it, I mean you should be able to list out every single step. Every reactant, every product, every reaction arrow, and every enzyme that's listed. One of the best ways to do that is repetition. Draw, 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 draw. So be creative. Be creative with how you work those reps into your day. It takes like a million reps. Maybe not a million. 999,999, for instance, right? Rather than trying to do this in a big block of time at the end of the day, what I encourage you to do is just work it in throughout the day. This is a pretty simple energy system to draw, so it doesn't take that much time. If you just keep drawing it, drawing it, drawing it, you'll be able to get that down quick. Another foundational thing that's worth mentioning, all enzymes that catalyze these reactions, I have illustrated with green lightning bolts. Remember that the function of an enzyme is to lower the activation energy so that a reaction can actually occur. Without enzymes in our cells, many chemical reactions wouldn't occur. So enzymes make stuff happen. So as you look further at the various processes in the Metabolism Lecture Series, please always note that when you see these green lightning bolts, that simply means that's an enzyme that's catalyzing that reaction. In this case, I've illustrated all of the relevant enzymes because there's only a few steps. But in some of the more elaborate metabolic processes, I'll only illustrate the rate-limiting enzyme. That's basically the head honcho, the one that's often the focal point of research. Even though there's lots of enzymes at work, I typically only want you to know the rate-limiting enzyme. So if I have shown an enzyme somewhere in one of your metabolic processes, well then I want you to know that enzyme. For some visual flair, whenever an enzyme catalyzes a reaction in these videos, I'm going to have my buddy Thor bring in the lightning for it. Before I dive into the various reactions for the immediate system, I'd like to point out it actually goes by multiple names. So as you're talking with individuals or reading other content online or in books, please note that this is the same system as the phosphagen system, the creatine system, phosphocreatine system, creatine phosphate system. They're all the same thing. I like the use of the word immediate as it applies to this system. Because as we dive into its application a little bit more, one of the recurrent themes is that this system allows us to gain ATP energy, boom, like that, in an instant, immediately. So that name, immediate system, I think well encapsulates one of the primary functions of this system. I like to refer to this system as phosphates on tap. It's like having phosphate energy to power sliding filament mechanism literally on a tap. Anytime you want them, you just open up the tap, pour it on in the cup. Woo! Phosphate party! So how is it that we have phosphates on tap? Well, we'll dive into that with those specific reactions. Phosphate party! And while it's not necessarily colored or listed on the board behind me here, please remember that all of this is occurring in the muscle sarcoplasm. So in reference to your ninja slides, I want you to go back through those overview points and note the location of the immediate system. That has some implications down the road in a further episode with regard to limiting factors for immediate system and for the glycolytic system. Let's go ahead and dive into some of the reactions that we see right here. The first thing to note, of course, is that there's three reactions. And this central reaction right here may look a little familiar to you. We start with ATP participating in a hydrolysis reaction with water. Hydrolysis basically means that we're splitting something apart in the presence of water. And ATP plus water is going to be catalyzed by this enzyme, myosin ATPase. If that sounds familiar, you've seen this in the sliding filament mechanism. This would be attached to the myosin head, splitting ATP apart. So what do we get after this reaction? Well, we get ADP and phosphate. Remember, those would be attached to the myosin head. And then once phosphate's released, we initiate the power stroke, actin myosin sliding, which essentially is muscle contraction. So this central reaction really is not an ATP production reaction. What this is the ATP utilization reaction. Once we've utilized ATP then, we need to be able to rapidly generate more. Our muscles can't store up a ton of ATP. Theoretically, we have enough ATP stored in our muscles to power about 2 seconds of activity. It's not a whole heck of a lot. So, within the immediate system, we've got two side reactions that illustrate how we can rapidly produce some new ATP to power this central reaction right here. The go-to side reaction I've listed here as a number 2. That's what we would refer to as a creatine kinase reaction, because creatine kinase is the enzyme that catalyzes that. And what you'll see is from this ADP that was left from the central reaction, that ADP will participate in a reaction with stored creatine phosphate. We can store up a lot more creatine phosphate in our muscles than we can ATP. So in this reaction, we're gonna steal a phosphate from that creatine and add it to this ADP. So what we emerge with is ATP again and creatine. Now that creatine is gonna hang out in the muscle sarcoplasm until we can attach a phosphate to it and it could participate in something like this again. It's worth mentioning that we have about 2 grams of creatine stored up in every kilogram of skeletal muscle. Half of the creatine comes from diet and the other half is manufactured in the kidneys and the liver. I'll circle back to that a little bit later when we talk about how we might be able to improve the functionality of this system. But 2 grams per kilogram is a considerably larger amount than what we can store up as just ATP. And because we're constantly breaking down ATP, replenishing ATP, it's been estimated that the average person creates 200 kilograms of ATP per day. 200 kilograms. Can you imagine if we stored all that ATP up? We'd all be 400 or 500 pounds. So I think that amount of ATP production speaks well to the fact that we're constantly utilizing ATP to power skeletal muscle contraction throughout our day. Also speaks well to the value of this side reaction here to rapidly replenish the ATP that we're burning up. Now, in reference to your ninja slides, you'll see that our ability to rapidly produce ATP in the immediate system seems to be tied to these creatine phosphate stores. I'll refer to it as the creatine phosphate well, such that if you were to do some sort of a high intensity activity, immediately picture going out and running on a track at top speed. You start from a dead stop, and then you start doing your best to imitate Usain Bolt. In those first couple seconds, we're going to utilize our stored ATP to power that high intensity activity. But once we've burned through that limited reserve of ATP, in order to keep running full tilt, we need to start drawing on this creatine phosphate well. And as you can see in the image on screen, our ATP stores remain fairly high so long as we've got creatine phosphate to burn. But once the creatine phosphate well starts to dry up about 10 to 15 seconds into it, well, then you'll see that our ATP availability begins to dry up. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that 10 to 15 seconds in, you fall flat on your face, that you've got no energy left. We have a backup reaction in the immediate system, and that's this one right over here on the left. This is called the myokinase reaction in reference to the enzyme that catalyzes it. And this reaction is constituted by taking two ADPs, stealing one phosphate from an ADP, and attaching it to the other. And what we emerge with then is ATP and some AMP, adenosine monophosphate. Because this is requiring two ADPs from the skeletal muscle contraction process, it's a slower reaction. So it is hardly the go-to. This is always the go-to as it relates to a rapid replenishment of ATP. But when this creatine phosphate well starts to run dry, we need to have another way to rapidly produce ATP. And even though this isn't as fast, it's still fairly fast. Now, in reference to the energy systems that I've got on screen, you can see that if you were running full tilt as long as you could, you may get about 10 to 15 seconds into that before we start tapping into this myokinase reaction. All the while, from the time you started to the time that the immediate system is beginning to get tapped out, notice that the glycolytic system is beginning to ramp up. That means there's got to be some sort of a trigger that would signal for glycolysis and the associated processes to ramp up. Two powerful triggers to ramp up glycolytic activity are found within the immediate system. Muscle contraction, the actual process of contracting your muscles, would stimulate those muscle receptors that we've learned about already in the neuromuscular series. And the central nervous system, in response to that muscle contraction, begins to send out hormones that would signal for enhanced glycolytic activity. When we start to run dry in our creatine phosphate well, and we have to start relying more on this myokinase reaction, note that we're going to start to build up adenosine monophosphate. And as adenosine monophosphate accumulates in the muscle sarcoplasm, well, that's another powerful signal for glycolytic activity. So in summary, two triggers for the immediate system to ramp up glycolytic activity to essentially take its place if it gets tapped out are muscle contraction and AMP buildup. I'll mention this later in episode 6. This creatine phosphate well essentially acts as a limiting factor for the immediate energy system. The more creatine phosphate we have, the longer this thing can run. So I've got a ninja point for you. I'd like to circle back to that idea that we have about 2 grams of creatine phosphate per kilogram of skeletal muscle. There is a way to improve the immediate system function. And the most common way to do that is with creatine supplementation. You can go to most supplement stores, heck, even grocery stores, and buy big old jugs of creatine monohydrate. Not creatine phosphate, but creatine monohydrate. And the idea behind supplementation is that you would ingest a bunch of creatine in the hopes that you could get more creatine loaded into your muscles, and that extra creatine attaches with extra phosphates so that you deepen or expand the creatine phosphate well. It's been estimated that a muscle that's fully saturated with creatine phosphate stores about 3 grams of that, an extra gram from what we would normally naturally have. It's important to understand that our body already manufactures creatine. Most people already consume creatine in their diet. It's found in abundance in things like red meat, chicken, fish, eggs. So one can supplement with creatine without having to find the big old tub of creatine. How would you go about supplementing with creatine? Typical recommendations are that you would go through a week of loading. And that loading would look like 20 to 25 grams of creatine consumed per day to try and fully saturate those muscles, get up to that max limit of about 3 grams per kilogram of body weight. Once that loading phase is complete, then you would shift into what they call a maintenance phase, and that might consist of about 5 to 7 grams of creatine per day. So if you didn't want to go and buy some sort of creatine supplement, please know that, again, your body makes creatine naturally and that you consume it in food. I personally think food is tastier. It might be easier for me to just have a steak at the end of the night, probably more expensive, but certainly tastier, so that I could get the same amount of creatine into my muscles. Also notable is that that loading phase, while it's often recommended as 20 grams per day for about a week, most studies have found that you can fully saturate your muscles with creatine over a longer period of lower dosages. I think that syncs well with the nutritional approach if you're trying to maximize creatine stores in your muscles. The idea of supplementation is improvement of immediate system function. So from an application standpoint, what would that look like? Well, typically, a normally operating immediate system should be able to run all out for about 10 to 15 seconds. For the fastest sprinters out there, that's going to get them about 100 meters before they have to start relying on glycolysis as a dominant energy system. For the rest of us, I don't even know if we'd get 100 meters, but 10 to 15 seconds is very normal for all-out immediate system use before it begins to limp along because this creatine phosphate well is exhausted. If we're eating more creatine, if we're consuming more creatine, if we're supplementing with more creatine, if we're able to expand this creatine phosphate well, perhaps we can increase the maximum duration of immediate system use by 2 to 3 seconds. Now that might not seem like it's a very big deal, but it actually can be a huge deal as it relates to training and fitness improvements. That extra 2 to 3 seconds is often an extra rep or two from a resistance training standpoint. Maybe it's an extra set, maybe it's an extra sprint. And the name of the game as it relates to fitness improvement is optimization of fitness stimuli. If you're able to get that extra rep in every single workout taken across time, that's likely to elicit larger fitness improvements. So creatine is sometimes misunderstood or mismarketed as a weight gainer. That's actually incorrect. Its purpose is a performance enhancer. It lengthens the amount of time that we can utilize the immediate energy system in an all-out manner. And if you were to take advantage of that, well, then you might improve your fitness faster. If your training goal was to gain mass, well, creatine phosphate might contribute indirectly to that goal, but it's not going to directly make you larger. On that note, people tend to retain water a little bit more when they're supplementing with creatine, so they may notice a very acute bump up in weight, again, feeding into this idea that it's a weight gainer, but it's really just water weight. If someone was to get on creatine, gain 5 pounds, and then get off creatine, they would see that 5 pounds basically just be flushed away. The only way creatine really helps with weight gain is if you're utilizing it to optimize your workouts over time. So in summary, media energy system's function is to provide us with ATP energy now. Whether you're getting up out of bed or a chair, or whether you're doing something super high intensity, the primary function of the immediate system is to be able to give you ATP rapidly while we're waiting for glycolysis and mitochondrial respiration to ramp up and provide some additional ATP to help suit the needs of whatever our activity is. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video on the immediate system. Check out the next episode on carbohydrate metabolism when you're ready to start sipping on G6P.